Peter chapter 1, book of 1 Peter chapter 1, Hebrews, James, and then 1 Peter. They say, mentioned we'd like to have our first dinner together, 4th of July. I think it'll be safe enough. Jimmy's spreading every week anyway, and I think it'll be okay for us to have our dinner. AC, and maybe we can talk to mailman grilling us some hamburgers and hot dogs, and then you folks can bring the rest. I'm looking forward to it. Since we haven't come to you in a long time, it's been good to get together. Yeah, Joe's rubbing his tummy. God is good, isn't he? He's good in spite of us. Don't let a woman or her little grandson whose face was sprinkled with bright freckles spent the day at the zoo. Lots of children were waiting in line to get their cheeks painted by a local artist who was decorating them with tiger paws. You've got so many freckles, there's no place to paint. That girl in the line said to the little fella that she was in front of him. Embarrassed, the little boy dropped his head. His grandmother knelt down next to him and said, "I love your freckles. When I was a little girl, I always wanted freckles." She said while tracing her finger across his cheek, "Freckles are beautiful." The boy looked up. "Really, Grandma?" "Of course," said the grandmother. "Why, just name me one thing that's prettier than freckles." Little boy thought for a moment, looked intensely into his grandma's face, and then softly whispered, "Wrinkles." I like that one, don't you? First Peter chapter 1, we're going to just help us with life. For me, life is just one big exam. You have one test right after another. And some questions are easy and some are hard. But this old exam that we're going through right now will be over one of these days. And the main thing is work hard, study hard, and try to get it passed. Amen.
Amen.
And be ready for the other side. 1 Peter chapter 1, we'll look at verses 6 through 9. Father, help us as we study together tonight and bless the Lord's Supper in a special way. It's special to us, Lord. We remember what you did for us while you were here. Help each one of us to receive a blessing from your word tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. "Wherein ye greatly rejoice, though now for a season, if ye need be, ye are in heaviness through manifold temptations or tests, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen ye love." We haven't seen him, but we still love him. "In whom, though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, even the salvation of your soul." Every one of us will be tested and tried. That's just normal. That's life. That's what happens to us as a believer. And personal experiences bears out this truth. Verse 6 says, "In heaviness, distress." There's not too many days that we don't have a moment of distress of some kind, heaviness about somebody or something. As I said, I feel like life is just one big test. It's just an exam. You either pass or you fail. Some things are hard, some things are easy, but it's just a big test. But thank God, according to verse 6, these trials and testing come and go. They don't come to stay. One old black preacher used to say, I'm glad the Bible says, and it came to pass, amen, didn't come to stay. For a season, these seem to have seasons about them. And we understand about a season, we have four of them. Spring, summer, fall, and winter. And we know what to expect from each season. We know what it's going to be like springtime and summer's coming on and then fall and then winter. And we know pretty well what to expect from each season. And as we grow older as a Christian and in age, we pretty well know what the tests are going to be. As you get older, it's going to affect you more physically. When you're younger, it's more spiritual and maybe financial. But we pretty well know what each season is going to bring. But thank God that these testings and trials aren't a constant same thing. And we do have breaks in between each and every one of them. In Luke chapter 4 and verse 13, the Bible says, when the devil had ended all the temptations or the tests for Jesus, he departed from him for a season. He departed for a season. He didn't leave. He didn't pack up and leave for good. And we, if we're not careful, probably would think that Jesus only faced this temptation one time with the devil. But according to the word of God, the devil just left for a little while and he came back. And that's the way it is for us. The tests, the trials, they may just last for a little while or a season, but I guarantee you there's going to be some more. And there's no way you and I are going to escape it. These trials and testings are for a purpose. In verse 6, if need be, if I need to be tested or tried in some fashion or manner, it's going to happen. I can't stop it. All I can do is adjust to it, deal with it, and keep moving. If need be, on purpose, these trials and tests are not an accident. They're there on purpose. And it's good to know that nothing can cross his desk or get to us until it does cross his desk. He's the one that orchestrates trials and testing. I don't understand all that. I certainly can't comprehend everything. But the Bible does share some reasons as to why we have to be tested and we have to be tried. They're for a purpose. Daniel had to be thrown in the lion's den. Joseph had to be tested. Moses had to be tested. David had to be tested. Everybody in the Bible had to pass exams. They had to go through these tests and trials. And some passed and some didn't. But it's up to us to pass those tests to the best of our ability. and keep on moving. You notice I use that term, keep on moving. You can't give up, no matter how you feel, what you're going through, what your experiences may be, whether you fail or whether you are a success or whatever's going on in your life, you have to keep moving. That's the key, that's the main thing. And verse 7, the writer John said, or Peter says, that these tests are to prove our faith. He says that the trial of our faith may be tested. If your faith is not tested, then it's really not faith.
Amen.
Our faith has to be tested. C.S. Lewis is one of my favorite writers, authors, and he said, suffering insists upon being attended to. He said, God whispers in our pleasures. He said, God speaks to us through our conscience, but God shouts to us in our pain. I mean, we get the message when we hurt bad enough, amen? We really do. And if the trial or test is hard enough, then we get the message, that's for sure. Now, we can have a choice. We can respond to suffering like a potato or an egg. You drop a potato in hot water, and it comes out soft. You drop an egg in the same hot water, and it comes out hard. So no matter what the trial or test, we're either coming out soft or we're going to come out hard. It's up to us to make that decision. So these tests and trials that we're going through, we don't like them, and sometimes there's a heaviness there. We're distressed. My goodness, this is rough. But there's a purpose for it.
Yeah, yes.
And eventually that purpose will surface and we'll see it, be satisfied with it. And then sometimes these trials and testings are just to discipline us. We get out of line and get out of sorts with the Lord sometimes, and He has to come along and say, now wait a minute, boy. I'm going to have to get you back in line. It'll be some kind of a test or a trial. Did you know the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 5 that Jesus learned obedience by the things that He suffered while He was here in this world? That's how He learned obedience, just like we learned obedience. But what we go through, what pain we might feel or what we might suffer, or trials and testing. He had trials and testing. In fact, He was tempted in all points like we are. Every once in a while when I'm tested or tried, I'll say, "Boy, Lord, did you feel what I'm feeling? You know what I'm going through? You feel this, what I'm feeling at this moment?" The Bible says He does. Tested in all points, like as we are. So, when we go through a test or a trial, don't feel like you're the Lone Ranger, that you're the only one going through that, or you've been through that, or you're suffering that, or you're feeling that. We know Jesus feels it, and I'm sure other people in this world are feeling something similar, or not the same thing. So we're all in the same boat. We really are. That's why jails are necessary. Even if we are honest, the threat of jail keeps some people from breaking the law. Why is it when you're driving down the highway and you see a police car, that foot backs off and accelerates? Your foot today. My God, Peggy said, must be a policeman over there today. When I let up on that gas pedal. Did you see a police? Oh, there's a police. That's automatic. Automatic. That's why spanking is necessary. When you're disciplined, when you discipline a child, sometimes it's necessary to give them a little spanking. Daniela used to tell me all the time, Papa, you're in timeout. What do you mean timeout? You're in timeout because you're not acting right. You're not behaving right. You're in timeout, Papa. So I stay in timeout about two-thirds of the time. But obedience is learned by our behavior. You know, Dad didn't have to tell me but one time what to do. I mean, if he hadn't told me the second time, it got rough. Why is discipline so important? Well, it helps us, that's all. And then according to 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5, it humbles us to go through trials and testing. When we're tested or tried, we say, my goodness, I didn't realize I could think those things, or I could act like that, or I could do that, or I could behave that way. I thought maybe I would do better. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Don't be ashamed when you feel dread or fear. Don't be afraid when you feel like you failed, and don't be ashamed when God knows that. He understands that, and He's willing to help us through those times. And He wants us to just call on Him and ask Him to help us through these tough times. Whether we failed or whether we succeed or whatever's going on, He's interested in it. He'll help us. He humbles us. He has a way of coming in and says, you're not nearly as good a Christian as you think you are. You're not doing as nearly as good a job as you think you are. You need to come down off that high horse and get this thing straightened out. Dr. Alan Redpath, I read after him, he said, when God wants to do an impossible job, He takes an impossible man and just crushes him. He just has to crush us sometimes because it's necessary. And then verse 7, we go through these testings and trials to purify us. We're tried by fire. Faith that has not been tried is not faith. I mean, your faith has to be tried. Mine has to be tried. And if it's not tried, it's not really faith. Fire hurts, but it purifies, amen, if it's used properly. And then 2 Corinthians 1:4, these tests and trials that we go through is to qualify us to help others, who comfort us in all of our tribulation and trial, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. A lady that I heard about at Jack Hiles' pastor's school, he used her as an illustration. She was a member of his church. She was expecting a baby, had a miscarriage, and it really grieved her. But you know how she reacted? She adjusted to that trial. Every morning she would get the newspaper for him in Indiana. She would look through the obituary if there's a little baby or a little child that has died that week, whatever purpose or whatever reason, she contacted that mother and shared with that mother what she had gone through and shared with that mother what Jesus could do for her. When you get comfort, you get help when you're going through a trial, then God expects us to help somebody else that's going through something like that. Amen. That's why one of the reasons we're going through it, so we can help somebody else. And then God wants to prove that His grace is sufficient. Many, many times when we're going through a trial or a temptation or a test, God will move in and He'll solve it right away. He'll get us through it right away. But then other times, He just gives us grace to endure it, to go through it, to put up with it, and to keep moving. That's what Paul experienced. He had every day he faced this one test or trial, whatever it was, nobody knows. He prayed and asked God to take it away so he could be a better person. God said, no, not take it away, but I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll give you grace to bear.
Amen.
Until the day Paul died, he had to deal with that. Whatever it was, he had to deal with it every day until he died. But God gave him grace every day the rest of his life to deal with that trial or test, whatever it was. So the Lord is there. Sometimes He delivers us immediately. Sometimes He just, over a long period of time, just gives us grace to deal with whatever situation we have to deal with. And then, sometimes God just calls some folks to suffer. It just seems like they are going through some trial or test all the time. That's what He said about the Apostle Paul. He said, I'll show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Boy, that calling, isn't it? That's what He told Paul. I'm going to show you how much you have to suffer for my sake. And in John chapter 9, somebody asked Jesus if the blind man sinned or his parents said he was born that way. And Jesus said, neither one. He was born that way, so that the works of God would be manifest in him. You and I have no idea how effective it might be when we're going through a trial or a test if somebody else is watching us and they say, if that person can go through that, then maybe I can go through it too. And it helps. But God always provides grace if He doesn't immediately deliver us. Thank God for that. And then, these tests and trials, they're a lot of a gain and a lot of profit for them. But the thing behind all of it, the thing that God is working on and doing, is preparing us for Him to come again.
Amen.
He's trying to get us in a place where we would be better Christians when He comes back. And so that's the reason that we go through these trials and these temptations and these testing to help us be better prepared for the coming of the Lord. That's what He says here. Be found in the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. The Lord wants faith to be purified, active, and seen when He comes back again. That's the reason He made this statement. Will the Son of Man find faith when He comes back again? Well, it'd be up to us. that he does find favor. That we take the trials and tests and temptations and whatever we are going through, look to him, put it in his hands, and just keep on moving. I love to see people that just won't quit.
Amen.
They won't give up. They just keep moving. Just keep going. Here you are, Sunday morning, Sunday evening. I'll watch for you to come through that back door Wednesday evening. And I know that you have times when you don't feel like being here. I know that you have times when you're tempted, you're tested, you go through certain trials, and these things affect you just like they affect everybody else. The difference is, you just keep going. You just keep moving forward. You just keep your focus. That's what life's all about.
Amen.
It's just one big test, and we're going to take a test tomorrow. I have no idea what the test is going to be, what it's going to be like, or what's involved in it, but I'll take a test tomorrow. I guarantee you. Some kind of a test, some kind of a temptation, some kind of a trial, some kind of a burden or problem, something is going to test me tomorrow. You too. That's life. But it's so important that we just keep taking and keep moving. Don't quit. Don't give up. That's what it's all about. That's a lot. One big test. One big exam. Some questions for you, some for me. All are common. The main thing is, keep moving. Amen.
Amen.
Our Father, we thank you for the privilege of being in your house. Lord, I ask you to encourage our people. My heart goes out to them when I know that they're going through a trial or test or hard time. I pray for them. If there's anything I can do to help, I'd certainly be glad to help and do it. Help us, Lord, to just love one another, encourage one another, do the best we can to help each other through these exams, these testings, these trials of life. And we know you're always there, and you will always care for us, and you will always provide for us. We give you thanks for it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Fellas, would you come?